For those who have been asking, and some have, this is obviously a quite distinctive room. It's a former ballroom. We have 3,000 students in our school, and we have an historic preservation program, and all the restoration here and the science, if you will, given the topic tonight, as well as the research that went into figuring out how this room was originally painted, how the carpet was woven, everything else that was done by our students. So this restoration is a function of what we do here at the school. It's my pleasure again to welcome all of you, and my remarks are meant to be very short, and I want to introduce our special guest. But I do want to say on behalf of a school dedicated to art and design, if you go across the street to the modern wing, you will see some sculptures by the very significant artist of the 20th century, Constantine Brancusi, who said that the art of the 20th century, when he was working, will be challenged by the scientist and the engineer. And he was absolutely right. The things that are happening in science and engineering and other areas of exploration are of great interest to artists today, to designers of all stripes, to our students especially. And so this is a unique opportunity for us to demonstrate that kind of synergy, especially when I'm sure you'll see some images tonight from Hubble. You'll be hard-pressed to say you're not looking at art on the highest order. I want to introduce Alan Treschein. Alan is the president and founder of the Chicago Council on Science and Technology and the director emeritus of the Argonne National Laboratory. Alan is the founder, and this is an organization dedicated to raising awareness in science and technology in the Chicagoland area, and having worked in several other areas of the country, bringing multiple and very strong partners, as we have here in Chicago, together to take maximum advantage of what they can do together is a real challenge, but when it works, it can be extraordinary, and I know Alan is the right person to be able to do this. Alan served as director of Argonne from 1983 to 1986. He joined Argonne after a long career with Exxon Corporation, and he was the first person to hold that position who came from industry, not necessarily from academia or from the pure sciences. He's a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, a member of the U.S. National Academy of Engineering, and past chairman of the National Conference on the Advancement of Research. He holds a bachelor's degree from the Brooklyn Polytechnic University in New York, and received his PhD in chemistry from Penn State. It's my distinct pleasure to bring Alan Treschein to the stage.
Thank you very much. I like to say that I was not the longest serving director of Argonne National Laboratory, but the longest surviving. It is also a great pleasure to welcome you here tonight on behalf of the organization that I have the opportunity to head, that is the Chicago Council of Science and Technology. I'll take just a minute or two to reinforce what Duke said. The organization was formed about 3 years ago by a group of people who have a great concern for delivering to the public the importance of science and technology for the health, welfare, well-being of our society. Dealing with issues such as stem cell research, nuclear power, art and science, and our next event, for example, follows a series of events we've had on critical issues concerning the Earth, so to speak, and that is on the important topic of water resources. The title is Water, the New Oil, and that's on November 12th. Now, I would encourage you, if you have an interest in these matters and have an interest in discussing those issues that are critical for the health of our society and the impact of science and technology, to join us. You've picked up perhaps the literature outside, if not access the website, very simple website to access, www.c2st.org. So that is my pitch, so to speak. Now I would like
Saturday morning.
I think it was about the time I decided to become an astronaut. I was taking the clay class when the instructor said of my bust of Abraham Lincoln, "Wow, that looks like the back end of a truck." And I decided to go into science. So that's only partially true, but the comment is actually quite true. And I did enjoy the time here. Thank you very much for inviting me. The University of Chicago played a huge part of my life, and growing up in Hyde Park as well. I had no idea when I was mixing with people who had worked with really famous, you know, wonderful scientists that someday I would be here talking about something like the Hubble Space Telescope. But even more amazing, and Rocky was the idea man here, on this last mission, I had an opportunity to take something for which maybe at the time Edwin Powell Hubble may have been more famous, which was a 1908-1909, this happens to be 1909, basketball. Hubble was, I think, point guard for the national championship team from the University of Chicago for 2 years running. In this particular case, this ball was the game ball against Indiana. Chicago also had the record of being the only school that went undefeated against Notre Dame. So it's this is a picture of Walter Adams, Edwin Powell Hubble in the middle, and Albert Einstein, which had a 100-inch telescope on Mount Wilson in California. This is 1931. And I just want to reflect back for a moment. Astronomy has been something important to people, you know, for time immemorial. You know, I'm convinced that as early man, you know, almost apes, you know, we looked up at the sky, we saw things, we wondered what's up there. But more importantly, we ask fundamental questions about ourselves. Where did we come from? Where are we going? How did the universe come to be and to look the way it does? How did the Earth form? All these very basic questions that inquiring minds want to know. And astronomy is one of those tools we use to answer those very fundamental questions. And there are many distinguished faculty members here in the audience who are working on those very fundamental questions. The Hubble Space Telescope is one tool that we have in order to answer those questions. The Hubble Space Telescope doesn't answer any questions. Astronomers answer those questions. And it's an amazing experience to be involved in that project. At the time that Hubble was at the University of Chicago, we lived in a universe that didn't have galaxies, that didn't originate in a Big Bang. We didn't know any of that. Even the idea that there were galaxies was still unknown. And actually, this is a picture that Hubble took. It was a glass plate. It had emulsion on it, and Hubble would then expose that glass plate to a large telescope and take pictures of fuzzy objects, nebula, that he would observe. We're not really used to looking at the negative images of things. So here's the inverse, the positive image. And in this picture, this fuzzy image, he and others determined that they were actually island universes. They were individual stars, and that they were actually a great distance. And so this was the origin of galaxies, that the universe filled with galaxies. And there were certain variable stars in these pictures that allowed Hubble to estimate the distance to those galaxies, kind of using the standard candle to know how bright it is. And you move it far away, then you can figure out how far away the candle is, the inverse square law. So he used that to look around at these nearby galaxies and discovered that we lived in an expanding universe. And this was less than 100 years ago. So our knowledge prior to that was really very primitive. So we've come a long way. And I'll describe a little bit of that. This basketball has come a long way as well. But I think the solid point is that in Hubble's time and now, people can be, you know, very multifaceted. They can be, you know, one of the most famous or the most famous American astronomer of the last century, as well as being great athletes or great scholars in other fields. And that's really the tradition, I think, of the University of Chicago and also the campus that we have, the Art Institute of Chicago, the School of the Art Institute, Hubble Planetarium. Active science program, the Field Museum, one of my favorites when I was a kid, the Museum of Science and Industry is a great place to learn about science. This is what it's going to look like in a few months in Chicago. This is actually a picture that I took in 1997, February of Chicago. But just to set sort of the scene, this is what it looks like from space, and somewhere about here is where we are now. This was from Space Shuttle Atlantis. I've flown out to Atlantis twice. This time we were docked to the Mir space station. And this is
what I looked like in 1967 at 55th and Kenwood during the Great Snowstorm of 1967. But at that time, I was already interested in going outside and building snow caves and out exploring. And about the same time, perhaps randomly, but Mrs. Lowe, my third grade teacher, asked me to do a biography of Enrico Fermi. And that was one of those pivotal moments in my life when I learned about another great explorer, Enrico Fermi. He was a mountaineer who loved climbing in the Dolomites. He was a fantastic experimental physicist, of course, the originator of the first atomic pile under Stagg Stadium, Stagg Field, the stadium at the University of Chicago, which I got to ride my little bike over and see before it became Regenstein Library. But he was also a great theorist, and we all, as an Italian-American physicist, a debt of gratitude to him, and I do as my hero, basically, as I was growing up, becoming a scientist. This last May, I got to go on my fifth adventure to space. In this case, it was back to the Hubble Space Telescope. On that 1997 mission, I called Car Talk for advice. I was pinned as a repair person. We had a very rookie crew and a very experienced crew going to Hubble this time. Scott Altman, the commander, was on his fourth space flight and his second to Hubble. He and I flew together in 2002 as well. And he is perhaps most famous as a famous film star. How many people have seen the movie Top Gun? Good, quite a few, yes. Well, there was some two-bit actor in Top Gun who had top billing and flying F-14s against Russian fighters, and actually Tom Cruise did not fly those jets. The Navy pilots, Fairmont Films paid the Navy for the operation of the aircraft carrier, and the pilots for flying the jets, plus, you know, a little bit of a stipend for the pilots. Scott was Tom Cruise's stand-in, and because he didn't have a speaking part, he was not asked to join the Screen Actors Guild, and he got paid as an extra $15 a day. I think Tom Cruise probably got paid a little bit more. And there's a famous scene, I don't know if you remember, of an inverted F-14 and then a Russian big fighter in a negative 2G pullover or something like that outside. And the Tom Cruise, Scott Altman actually, Scooter we call him, gave a friendly gesture to the Russian fighter. That was Scott's finger. Mike Massimino, on his second space flight, his second flight to Hubble also, he was another returning veteran from our STS-109 mission in 2002. Myself, of course, I was the lead for the spacewalks. And then we had four rookies. And by loading the deck with experienced Hubble folks, we were able to fly first-time flyers, and they all did a great job. Our pilot was Greg Johnston on his first flight, obviously. He's a Navy pilot with A-6s. Megan MacArthur, a PhD oceanographer from Scripps, UCLA. Was our flight engineer and robotic arm operator. My spacewalking partner, we did five spacewalks. I may call them EVAs at some point, extravehicular activity, back and forth. So if I say EVA, that means spacewalk. He was my spacewalking partner. We did EVAs 1, 3, and 5, spacewalks 1, 3, and 5. And Mike Good, and Drew is a geologist, exploration geologist at Exxon, Queens, PhD from Queens University in Canada. And Mike Good, Air Force colonel, radar intercept officer. On his first mission, he was Mike Massimino's partner for EVAs 2 and 4. So we blasted off in May, basically to do a complete Hubble makeover. We were going to put in new scientific instruments. Two of the scientific instruments on Hubble had failed, and so we were going to try a first ever in situ in orbit repair by pulling out circuit cards and putting in new circuit cards. I'm going to show you our home movie. So there'll be a bunch of things. The launch scene, grabbing Hubble, going out between spacewalks. And when we do the spacewalks, you'll see me removing some tiny screws. I had to remove a cover plate that had a little tiny number 4 screws on them. And then we do the same thing on another instrument. And then we put on some new computers, new batteries, gyros, and then closed up Hubble and set it up this way. So it's really a brand new telescope. So here we are. Kennedy Space Center. We have to have two space shuttles. You see Atlantis and Endeavour there. Endeavour was our rescue ship in case something went wrong. That's when the there we are walking out in our launch and entry suits of protective gear. we're climbing in. It's a little bit of a tight fit. That's Greg Johnson, our pilot, on Ray J. Megan was the last one in. Efforts that close the hatch. There are about 10,000 people that all have to do their job right for us to get over successfully. This is the flight director in Houston getting credits.
On behalf of the KSC processing launch team, I'd like to wish you, your crew, the whole Hubble Space Telescope team, a great mission. Good luck, guys. We'll see you back here in about 11 days.
And that's the launch director in Florida. The main engines turn on about 6 seconds prior to launch, so they're running. Then the solid rocket motors light, and then we're going somewhere. That was our first master alarm. That's not a good thing. Right about here was our second alarm, and then it got a lot more serious, and we were all a little bit more quiet. I'll tell you what they were after the film. But the ground said no action. That can mean a couple of things. One, there's nothing you can do about it, or it's not a problem. After 2 minutes, we get rid of the solid rocket motors. That's a view from the cameras on the solid rocket motors that will re-enter and will splash in the ocean. And there we are, heading off to orbit on the large orange tank that had the liquid fuel in it, with hydrogen and oxygen. That'll burn up in the atmosphere over the Indian Ocean. Once we're to orbit, we open the payload bay doors. I'm always amazed after rocking and rolling like that, it's floating out broken pieces of objects and things. And the next couple of days, we were chasing Hubble. Basically, we're now going 17,500 miles an hour, about 600 kilometers, 350 miles above planet Earth, catching up with the Hubble Space Telescope. I hadn't seen it in about 7 years, but it looked pretty good. Megan reached out with the robotic arm and grabbed it. It's got almost flying formation with it. And Hubble looked like it was dead still when she grabbed it. It was really amazing. In the meantime, we were turning our rocket ship from a rocket ship to a house on orbit, a place to work, getting all our tools out. We had over 400 specialized tools to repair Hubble. This is a power screwdriver. Getting the spacesuits ready, that's my helmet going into the airlock. Getting ready for flight day 4 when we do our first spacewalk. These are liquid cooling garments. That's what keeps us hot or cold, temperature control. Julie was eating a Cliff Bar there, last meal before going out into space. I'm single out of my family. And here I am, flight day 4, coming out of the airlock. My sister often asks, do I work in a vacuum? And I say, yes, I do. Drew had that big grin on his face, which he kept the whole time he was outside. Well, almost the whole time. The first bolt we had to take off on an old camera wouldn't turn. We were afraid we were going to break it. So he had to apply a little extra elbow grease.
Okay, here we go. I think I got it. It turned. It definitely turned. Yep.
So for about 20 minutes or so, we weren't sure we were going to get the old camera out, which would have been an incredible disappointment for the scientific community. But we did get that bulb, and it broke. It came free just before the failure torque, which it would have snapped, and we never would have gotten it out. So there I am within the telescope, pretending to be Edwin Hubble. I didn't have a pipe. This is the old camera coming out. These cameras are amazing digital cameras. And they push state of the art. The reason we have great cameras here on Earth is because of efforts like this. This is the new camera going in, and I'll show you some images from that. It's basically a 16 megapixel camera, and I'll describe why it's great. Typically, we have one person on the end of the robotic arm, the other person floating free, so that was floating free. Here, Drew is putting in a new spacecraft computer. The reason we actually delayed, I didn't describe this, from October to May of this year, was because a computer broke, and so Drew's on the end of the arm. I was installing a docking adapter on the bottom of Hubble, and here you see the view out of my helmet, looking at Hubble with the reflection of the Earth, and Drew's working on a latch there to finish off EVA-1, so here we're coming in on the arm. So Megan MacArthur is flying that robotic arm. In the payload bay, we have all the containers that hold the scientific instruments. Between EVAs, we have to change out hundreds of tools. There's one specialized screwdriver, and also the space suit. So it's a flurry of activity. You work really hard, and then you go to bed and wake up and do it all again. So this is Mike Massimino now, Mike Good. They're handing out the tool board that contains all those tools. This is the airlock. I'm looking down on the robotic arm. For this day, the main task was to change out some tiny gyroscopes on Hubble. And normally that's a pretty straightforward thing. We had, again, some troubles getting those gyroscopes in. They're behind these big doors. On the first servicing mission, when they went to close those doors, they wouldn't close. They again, it's a telescope. We like to make some dark inside. We couldn't close the doors. That would be the end of the telescope. So we learned sort of a mantra, don't break the telescope. I always try to do that. So this is Mike handing out one of these red box size gyros. Now Hubble is a really great telescope for a bunch of reasons, one of which is it's not a particularly big telescope, but it's above the Earth's atmosphere. And so it can see things that we can't see down here on Earth because of the shape of the atmosphere and because ultraviolet light doesn't get through the atmosphere. This is Mike Good, thrilled we put in the first of six gyros. The next two didn't go so well. And those gyros, though, are the other reason why Hubble is a great telescope. They're very, very sensitive, and they allow Hubble to point and stare in one position at a very distant part of the universe for a long period of time, like a time lapse or something. After 6 hours of a 6.5 hour day, we were done with the gyros, and we got to go to continue and change the batteries. On this mission, batteries were included. They're not little AA batteries. They're these big 380-pound nickel hydrogen batteries. Really amazing. They've been up there for 19 years, about 25 years old, and they get cycled once in orbit, which is 96 minutes around the Earth. These guys, after 8 hours, still relaxed. That's at the stage for EV83. EV83, this is me going out, and the big task was to change out something called the COSTAR, which was the corrective lenses, the contact lenses of Hubble, that we put in 1993 that corrected the wrong shape mirror, and then to try and repair the advanced camera for surveys, the same one of those repairs I mentioned. We opened the big doors. This is the COSTAR coming out. I convinced Drew that he should work out in the gym every day for 3 years to be able to hold this 800-pound instrument, the size of a big subsurface refrigerator. Of course, in orbit, it's all free-floating. But you still have to start and stop it and be able to control it. And here we are putting that instrument away. And Drew did a great job. We then put in the new spectrograph during a night pass, and we don't really see it. So now you'll see me inside of the telescope. This is Drew helping out like a surgeon's assistant as I remove these tiny screws. Many people have said this mission was dedicated to the study of the behavior of tiny screws in space. And there's a fair amount of truth to that. We actually employed a kind of neat trick. We had a cover plate that had holes in it that were small enough for the screwdriver to go through, but not big enough for the tiny screws to come out. So we got all those screws out, and there's the circuit boards I had to remove. They made one with a funny angle. I actually couldn't see all of this. I was working around a corner, so a lot of it was just by feel. Unfortunately, we developed a technique and got these cards out. I wasn't allowed to touch them. There were about 50 things. They said, oh, you can't touch that, it'll rip your space suit. I said, well, what about here? And they said, no, you can't touch that, it'll rip your space suit. We developed some neat tools. There Drew's got the old circuit boards, or actually the old cover plate there, in the way. And here we are coming over the Costa Baja, Mexico, coast of mainland Mexico, finishing up with that ACS task. And we had allotted 7.5 or 8 hours for this, and it turned out with all the practice I did and what we did as a team, this was exactly on target at 6.5 hours, and I was pretty happy. In fact, I was so happy, I slept really well that night. The next morning, Megan, after the alarm clock went off and the music played, I was still sleeping. She says, I think he's dead. But I had about 3 years of stress relieved that day, EA3. Eating in space, everything in space is fun and magical. I like to eat upside down like a bat. Drew likes to eat in the corner, but he has kind of a unique way to prepare his food. He's preparing a chicken tortilla. Kids, don't try this at home. No, says, I'll try it at home. It's a good demonstration for Abby. Enjoy that. The spacewalkers, we got plenty of exercise. The guys inside had a bike that they could ride to get exercise. Lots of bodily functions, you know, that we got to do in space. Another example, if you all know what this is, if you don't, you will in a minute. So this is Ray J describing. This is the tube that you key down, you know, for solid material. It goes in here. And we're very environmental friendly. We bring all that back to Earth. We don't have to do it in space. We did have some problems with the orbiter on board. We have a humidity separator. It takes humidity out of the air so our breath doesn't cause a lot of humidity buildup. And it was leaking, so we went down into the belly of the beast. Orbiter, and this is all the avionics. This is the humidity separator. Underneath these ribs is about 2.5 millimeters of aluminum, and then the tiles, and that's it. This is the skin of the orbiter. On the other side is a vacuum. So here's Scooter cleaning up that water. It was a lot of fun going inside. This is an experiment I did for as a national lab pathfinder for a company called BioServe in Colorado. Salmonella vaccine is what they're working on. finally can say I actually did science, where all I had to do is turn it around. I'll talk a little bit more about this later, but we actually have a replica of Galileo's telescope on board from a museum, the Science Museum in Florence, Galileo was from. And all I can say is he was an amazing observer. He thought it was a really bad telescope.
Now it's time for our favorite segment, which is
senior again.
Likewise. And your scooter's core. He's actually in his real corner.
So that's the flight deck of the Orbiter. Mike Massimino, believe it or not, wants to be a talk show host when he goes out. So he shot all of us after the EVAs and sent them down live to the ground. So anybody who followed the mission would see Scooter's Corner. There he is demonstrating that maneuver from Top Gun. We actually testified to the Science Subcommittee of the Senate, Barbara Mikulski's committee, from orbit. That was a lot of fun. She could see us. And apparently when we deployed Hubble in the cabin there, between EVAs, we had to get access to different sides of the telescope, so Hubble was put on a turntable. We would rotate Hubble around. Hubble's about the size of a school bus, 45 feet long, about 14 feet wide. On EVA 4, we tried the second instrument repair, again, taking out hanging screws. And even before we got to the screws, one of the big bolts got stripped. Right here, you can see it getting stripped by the power tool. We had to remove that yellow handrail before we could get to all those tiny screws that you see there. And for about 3.5 hours, we couldn't get that darn handrail off.
Sunset in 11 minutes.
And we really thought it was going to be a showstopper. Yeah, until somebody on the ground came up with a good idea.
Yeah, we're ready. Okay, Matt, you have a cover go.
So in about 60 pounds of forest mass, just Mike Massimino, Tom Mass, just broke it off. I said, that I can do. So that led the way then for us to start the EVA, basically. And this turned out to be another nail-biter, 8 hours. Here's another one of those cover plates that has tiny holes in it that the screwdriver would go through, but the screws wouldn't come back out. So you'll see Mike Massimino installing that. And then taking the cover plate off with the tiny screws, pulling the circuit card out. We now know what had failed. It was a common component of both these instruments. And the good news is they're both working now. And then coming back in the airlock. Fortunately, we were successful on that. And on the fifth EVA, Megan picked up again with flying the robotic arm. And on this EVA, we were going to change out the second battery. This time, I'm on the end of the robotic arm. And here I am coming down to meet Drew. Who's holding that battery again, all that jib time paid off. You can see I'm holding a tether. You know, we don't let anything go untethered, so we lose it. And then we also put in a new fine guidance sensor. And this is one of those other tools that allows Hubble to stare in one place for very long periods of time. About the size of a baby grand piano, about the same weight. Very easy to handle in space. As part of our complete makeover, we also put new insulation on the outside of the telescope to give it more longevity. Hubble's been up there 19 years. A little bit of luck, we should make it another 10 years. And really amazing, we got everything done and a little bit more than we planned on in our time. I gave Hubble one last tap and said, good luck on your voyages. And back in the airlock. And that's the stage for the Hubble deployment. Again, we lifted it up on the robotic arm and then got ready for Megan to let go. And Scooter was going to fire the orbiter jets and the nose to back out from under Hubble. And that's the least we can do, least perturbation, least disturbance to the Hubble Space Telescope as we went by. You would want to do all this work and then blast it with the jets. So this was our new
insight. I agree. Otherwise, you just got that.
I'm just like 5 seconds. The code switches in auto.
Believe it or not, there's 7 people on the flight deck. Looks closer, and I can tell you it looks a lot closer. But I mean, what are you going to do if it's going to hit?
hit you. Second isn't going to help. And then everybody gets the camera. And the last one's here. Film in. And now you can get a sense of a few more people. So here we are. This is Africa, Sahara in Africa, the Hubble Space Telescope. The good news is the aperture door is open. It's ready to do science. Once we deployed Hubble, we actually got ready to do a part of our deorbit burn, which was a safety measure for us. So that's Greg Johnson firing the orbiter jets. And this is probably the last time human eyeballs will actually look at Hubble during the sunset. And the next time we saw it, it was very distant, just a little bright star on the horizon, and we didn't see it anymore because we were in a different orbit. So here we are doing our deorbit burn. There's an orbiter floating in space. It's a shot of the toy. And that put us in an orbit instead of circular, a very elliptical orbit, down to 160. And here, that's the coast of California again, perhaps. Once we deployed Hubble, we had time to have some fun. Some people say stupid astronaut tricks. I like to do physics experiments. That's Tang. This is the first time in five missions that I ever got to play in space like this. We had a couple of wave-off days with bad weather in Florida. And so I got to do all those physics things I always wanted to do. On board while I was down there doing physics. Scott was playing video games with Ray J and flight engineer Megan. It happens to be a landing simulator. I was actually glad that he was practicing. There's the date about how he did. We did this for about an hour or so for each of the crew members. Then we got Scott up in his suit, and then he got out of his suit, and then he got in his suit the next day, and then he got out of his suit. Finally, on the third day, we got him back in his space suit. And this time he looks like he's ready to go. He's rocking to some tunes, thinking maybe we'll get waved off again. Megan's thinking, nah, I don't think so. And we did come in that day to Edwards Air Force Base in California. This is actually the shuttle encased by about a 2,500 degree plasma as we ionize the atmosphere coming in over the Pacific Ocean. It's nice to come in at night because you see that. And then finally back in daytime, we saw Edwards a few hundred miles out. And Scott Altman's job was to put the orbiter, the space shuttle, over a particular runway 200 feet wide by 15,000 feet long after being a glider for about 5,000 miles. It's a pretty impressive feat. First thing you have to do is get the landing gear down. It was Greg Johnson's job at about 300 feet. And then after traveling about 5.3 million miles, the scooter hits it right on the head, which is good because there's no engines. You have one chance to do it right. Anything other than that is disastrous, quite literally. We deploy a parachute so the nose gear doesn't hit too hard, it slows down. 197 orbits of the Earth with Hubble's basketball, we came to a stop. And that was a couple months before we knew whether Hubble was working or not. Unfortunately, it did. We didn't break the Hubble. We didn't stop back in California. So I now have a bunch of slides that will really culminate in what I want to show you some of the early results of Hubble. So we can go back to the slideshow. First thing I want to say is, being in space, being in Earth orbit, is just an incredible experience. It's very contrasty, very beautiful, very magical. This is, again, Drew and myself in the telescope. But here's our beautiful planet Earth. And what you're actually seeing here is the terminator between night and day. As we orbit the Earth, we go around once every 96 minutes, so we can see this 16 times a day. And of course, the Earth, we see it once every 24 hours. And it's just a very beautiful, very contrasting environment. It's also a contrast in terms of temperature. These spacesuits, wonderful spacesuits, inside we have pure oxygen at 4.3 psi, so we're inflated like the Michelin Man. That means we actually do have to do work against the suit. We see temperatures from minus 200 degrees Fahrenheit to plus 200 degrees Fahrenheit, as does the Hubble every orbit. That's why this insulation gets crinkly and why we replaced it. But it's also a place that's really not meant for humans, yet we thrive there to do things like prepare the Hubble and astronomy. I had a chance after the end of the EVH to pull out a camera and look back at the orbiter and take some pictures from space. And I said, hey, Drew, we could do something interesting. So, touch of the Earth and our visor. I really can't say enough about what a unique experience, amazing experience that is, that we get to go to space. Really excited for a great country that we live in, that we support things like this, and we support doing this drive. While I was at Caltech, I really wanted an office with a view. Right before I got selected to be an astronaut, I got a corner office with a view, and then a month later left. But this feet small. This is Megan's office. Really incredible to be able to look out and see planet Earth going by. Other unique things you can do in space, you can float in the middle of the cabin, this picture of Drew. And contrary to what you may have heard, astronauts really are different, because we do get to put our pants both legs on at the same time. I love taking pictures of planet Earth. I'll just show you one example, because I really want to get to the Hubble pictures. But this is the coast of Africa. West coast of Africa. Right here is one of the Cape Verde Islands, and there's a strong southerly flow of air, and there are these little lanes of vortices in the clouds where the wind goes over the island and fills it in the back. These are von Karman vortices, or you know, whatever you want to call it. But really just beautiful to be able to look out and see these kind of things on such a massive scale. I also, as I said, got to do a little bit of physics tricks. I wanted to make these water balls, and I'd always wondered, you know, what it would look like to focus on the water ball image of somebody in the background. So we had fun with that for a while. You can see Drew was holding a straw that we used then to drink that water. And I said, Drew, get really close to it. And get it. There's actually an analog of this and dark matter lensing of distant galaxies and gravitational lenses. This was my simulation of as I said, we have Galileo's telescope on board. This is the 400th anniversary of the use of the telescope for astronomy. 400 years ago, Galileo turned a telescope just like this, made with the same, this telescope was made with the leather from the same cows in the same field, with the same cows, with the same family of cows. The glass for the lenses and the grinding technique was a period glass from Italy, and the wood from the same type of trees. The problem is this telescope at about a meter long was too large to fit it anywhere in the space shuttle. So it's in the Florence, the Science Museum actually cut it in half. It's one of three replicas made as a period instrument. Put in threads, so we unscrewed it and put it back together. Mike Massimino, who's an Italian-American, will return that to Florence this December. And we tried and tried and tried to do astronomy with this telescope. Of course, this is a daytime shot. We tried at night. And you could really only see anything right in the center of the view, and even then it was pretty fuzzy. So I can tell you Galileo was a very patient observer to be able to see what he saw. He was the first one to actually look out and see the faces of Venus, the moons of Jupiter, mountains and canyons, and craters on the moon. And in a way started the scientific renaissance at the time by challenging the current ideas. And that's something that the Hubble Space Telescope and other astronomical observatories allowed us to do. Well, finally, we had to, as I said, set up the suit warehouse, get into our space suits, and come home on Atlantis. And what I'd like to do now is show you some of those Hubble early release observations. And there's no question that the universe is much more varied and much more beautiful than I think we ever imagined. And Hubble is kind of our eye on the universe. Now, these observations were picked not necessarily to discover new science. In fact, everything I'm going to show you, well, not quite everything, most of what I'm going to show you has been observed before, either with very large ground-based telescopes or by Hubble. This was to characterize the observatory and verify how everything worked. Now, before I start, I want to tell you that Hubble is a monochrome, black and white telescope. Every picture it takes is actually black and white, but we put colored filters in front of the camera and then take sequential images in red, green, blue, and also we'll take another image that may involve some specific physics. This is a particular light that comes from hydrogen atoms to add some science to it. And then we put all of those together to create the images that you see from Hubble that look like this. So this is a galaxy that has a telephone number with general catalog 6217. This happens to be taken with a combination of that advanced camera for surveys that we fixed and the new wide field camera. It's a galaxy much like our own. It has a very central, dense bulge of stars. In the center is a supermassive black hole. And then beautiful spiral arms.
This one's a little different than our galaxy in that in the spiral arms, you see regions where there's a lot of brand new stars being formed. They don't live very long, and they're very active and tend to end their lives in supernova explosions. Fortunately, we live in a very suburban galactic arm, so it doesn't happen very often. It's nice and quiet. But this was really wonderful for me to see if you could improve the moon instrument support and if you could fix the Hubble. Now, what you see here is a galaxy filled with stars. In the foreground, we're looking through stars in our own galaxy, and you can see those characterized with little crosses. That's a diffraction pattern in the telescope. So anytime you see that, that means it's something in the foreground. Everything else is something at great distances. Okay, so here's one of those calibration images. This is actually something called a globular cluster. It's a collection of about 10 million stars. It's called Omega Centauri, Omega Cent. It's about 10 million stars. These are, for the most part, very ancient stars. They're about 10, 11 billion years old. The globular cluster is a spherical ball of stars. They were all formed about the same time. And our galaxy has a bunch of these little satellite globular clusters orbiting around them, so we may actually capture those. And the color of the stars tell you a little bit about how massive they are, what temperature they are. And so the yellow stars are very much like our sun. Now, there probably aren't very many planetary systems, if any, in globular clusters. But if there were, the sky would be about 100 times brighter because these stars are much closer together than the stars around us and the Milky Way are from the spiral arm. So this picture is almost a stellar laboratory. And 25 years ago, this would have been a PhD thesis or two or three or four buried in here because there's all sorts of interesting physics. Stars do collide occasionally and it re-energizes these old stars and turns them into very blue hot stars called blue stragglers. So we can study how stars evolve. And this is getting back to those fundamental questions. How did the solar system form? How did the galaxy form? These are laboratories to study that. Of course, then there's also the view, for instance, of our pilot, Greg Johnson, who's not a physicist. And he said, wow, looks like Christmas. And it does. Talking about where stars form, this is we call it a molecular cloud. It's actually a dense, cloud, if you will, of hydrogen gas and other gases. And the colors, I told you about red, green, blue filters. These colors are actually picked to select specific elements. So this is a picture that's taken. It's in the Carina Nebula. You can see it from the southern hemisphere. It's in another spiral arm, so we're looking quite a distance away, a few thousand light years. And in the middle of this dense cloud, and these colors represent sulfur and nitrogen and oxygen, in the middle of this dense cloud, there's a new star forming right here. Now, this happens to be what's called a Herbig-Haro object after the two astronomers discovered it. It's catalog number 666, which led some astronomer to label it the axis of evil. But for another reason, there's sort of a jet of material coming out here, and it extends all the way out like this. Now, off screen, there's a very massive star that produces lots of ultraviolet light. And like lighting up a fluorescent bulb, it's lighting up this nebula. So there's a lot of ultraviolet light hitting this, causing these atoms to glow. They're the sulfur atoms, doubly ionized sulfur. And it's also boiling off this material from the outside. You see it wind, if you will. So this is a stellar nursery. Now with this new wide field camera 3 that we put in, this super duper digital camera, we don't just have the ability to look at it in the optical. Hubble is an optical telescope like our eyeballs. We also have this new infrared channel. The neat feature about the infrared channel is that it can penetrate through the dust. It's a long enough wavelength that you can look through this. And when you look at it with the infrared camera, boom, here's this star, and here are these jets extending out. And so this is a stellar nursery, and there's a bunch of other stars. So I'm going to flip back and forth just a little so you can see how that works. So this is a neat new feature on Hubble that's going to give us the ability to explore in very dense regions. And probably, there is a disk of dust around the star, and that dust is coming together and forming a new planetary system as well. We now know about 400 planets outside of our own solar system, and it looks like planet formation is a natural part of star formation in these dense clouds. Now, eventually, this star is going to get hot enough that it will create a bubble here, and the ultraviolet light will push out material, and this star will become visible in a few thousand. At the other end of the spectrum is what happens to stars when they die. This is a star that's about 5 times the mass of our sun, and it's running out of hydrogen fuel. And And as it dies, it kicks out its outer envelope. It's probably rotating. It probably has a disk here, and it's rotating rapidly, and that accounts for the asymmetry. And over the past few thousand years, it's had a couple of major eruptions. To give you an idea of the speed of this gas is traveling at about 500,000 miles an hour, 850,000 kilometers an hour. If you know, material was flowing out from the Earth this fast, it would only take about 20 minutes to get past the moon. So it's really cruising. With Hubble, we can study in detail these various shock fronts and how this evolves. Our sun probably won't end up like this, but many stars will. This is generically called a planetary nebula. This one's named the Butterfly Nebula or the Bug Nebula. And this is how most stars will have, you know, a few solar masses, a few times the mass of our sun or so will die. And I really encourage folks to go online. You can go to just do a Google search on Hubblesite.org and look at these in detail. Even looking at it on this map screen, it's amazing how much amazing detail there is. It would be very hard to imagine trying to paint something like this or imagine. And there are thousands of these that Hubble has taken. Quite a much longer distances. This is an astronomer named Stefan in 1800 observed this quintet of galaxies. There's one here, this nice spiral galaxy. There are actually two here, a fourth one here, and a fifth one here. These three are actually all about the same distance, at about 300 million light years away. This one's only at about 40 million light years. And you can actually start to see a little cosmology. These being farther away, they're a little bit more red and more yellow. In this galaxy, also a spiral galaxy, you can see these star formation regions. And Hubble has the ability to look and resolve individual stars in these galaxies. These two are of particular interest because they're in the act of colliding. And in that collision, there's a gravitational disruption. These long tails of gas are going out. And in those tails of gas, new star regions are forming. And they'll become little dwarf galaxies and fly off. And that cosmic dance will go on for a couple hundred million years or so until these merge to form a much larger galaxy. The black holes will merge. And not to alarm you, please don't rush for the exits. And we are going to collide with Andromeda. We're on a collision course with Andromeda Galaxy. And it will be one of these collisions. Lots of interesting things will happen. Fortunately, it's a few million years from now, so I don't think we really have to worry much about that. One of the other cameras, new instruments that we put in is the cosmic origin spectrograph. It's a little hard to see, but another thing very massive stars will do when they're at the end of their life is blow up as a supernova. And this is a supernova remnant, a few thousand years old. It's kind of a spherical, what we're looking at is a bubble. The star was in the middle. This gas is expanding. And with a spectrograph, we've taken a picture of this little region. And what a spectrograph does is like a prism break light up into its component colors. And so wavelength is essentially the same as color. And by looking at how much intensity there is in each color, we can actually identify what chemical elements are in this gas. So at this point, I want everybody to take a really deep breath. Add one more, why not? I won't make you pay for that later. All of that oxygen that you just breathed in, and all of the carbon that we're made out of, was formed inside stars. We actually have some experts in the audience here. In the Big Bang, the universe was created. We created hydrogen, a little bit of helium, a tiny bit of other stuff, lithium and other things. But everything that really we depend on, if you want to know where did we come from, we came from inside of stars, the stellar furnace that burns hydrogen and helium into carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, all the elements up through iron and a little bit of heavier stuff. But everything heavier than nickel was actually made inside of a supernova explosion. Had to be then sent out into space. And so we'll be able to study that with COGS, the cosmic origin spectrograph. But it's kind of neat to think that our bodies had to be processed, in other words, born in the center of stars, and then those stars had to explode. 2 to 3 supernova explosions in order to account for the composition of our bodies and the Earth and the planets in our solar system. Pretty neat stuff. Now look back at your vitamin bottle sometime. Now, if you believe the marketing that those are actually required for life, that's one thing. But there's a lot of heavy elements in there that all came that we need for various enzymes and chemical processes that come from supernova explosions that we're made out of. We really are star stuff. This is actually the first picture that we took with Hubble after the complete makeover. It's a picture of Jupiter. It was taken July 23rd, 2009. And the reason this was taken is because an amateur observer in Australia spied this kind of dark region down here. Now, 15 years ago, comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 plowed into Jupiter. As we went in, it broke up into pieces, kind of string of pearls, and we saw those collisions make a huge scar on Jupiter. And we thought, wow, we are so lucky that we've launched the Hubble. And then given the optics were bad at first, we were able to repair it on the first servicing mission. And then we got to see Jupiter in this once-in-a-lifetime, you know, once-in-a-100-year event in Shoemaker-Levy 9 in Jupiter. And we saw the amazing devastation as those plowed into Jupiter, that they burned up kind of in Jupiter's atmosphere, turned into dust, and scarred Jupiter in huge waves going out much bigger than the Earth. Well, it turns out those aren't one-in-a-100-year events. They're one-in-15-year events, approximately, because another one, we didn't actually see what it was. Something a few hundred meters across in Jupiter and made this dark scar. This is actually ash from that object in Jupiter. And you might say, well, that's very nice. And why do we care? And the reason we care is that's the same scale as the size of the Earth. And so, earlier this month, something about 10 meters across entered the Earth over Indonesia. It's not outside of Asia, it wasn't very widely talked about, and set off the nuclear test ban detectors all around the Earth. So about a 50 kiloton atmospheric explosion when this 10 meter object, 33 feet across, burned up and blew up in the atmosphere. It came in and then started slowing down like the space shuttle, but it's not in good shape like the Earth. It actually didn't have scientific driving. And so the pressures caused it to burst apart in this huge 50 kiloton air burst. This was much bigger, and if this had happened, you know, we wouldn't be here most likely. If that had hit the Earth, that would have been a climate changing dinosaur type event. Not really a mass extinction, but we'd all be in big warm coats, and the sun would be blotted out, and all sorts of nasty things like that. And let me just editorialize for a moment. Bits of the moon, about the size of a fist, were raining down on the Earth. Now, if you were a dinosaur 95 million years ago, a big rock came down and crashed, there would be a lot of noise, fire, you know, big crater. The first one, you would have said, ooh, that's scary. And the second or third, in a few days, for weeks, you would have identified that as a threat. Those dinosaurs had 30 million years to evolve. Asteroid reflection, space flight, live on Mars, shelters, climate change controls, 30 million years to be able to address that threat. And they chose not to. And 65 million years ago, they were wiped out by another. Instead of hitting the moon, it hit the Earth. And so the point of that fun video is, here we are, we have challenges on Earth. We have climate change that we are certainly causing. There will be winners and losers, but far more losers than winners. And we can be smart about dealing with these challenges. We still have the asteroids threat. So I'm a big believer in space exploration, but also in the human spirit, that we will use our talents the way we have to fix Hubble to also address these challenges. So I'm very optimistic that it's going to be a lot of hard work, and it's going to take everybody to do it. And it'll result in a much better planet. The Hubble story, though, really isn't coming to an end. That was the last Hubble servicing mission. The last time Hubble's basketball will probably be in active play on orbit anyway. But the Hubble story actually is just beginning, and that's because for the first time we have a Hubble with all new instruments, all this new capability. And every time we've had that in the past, we've had some amazing discoveries, and I'm looking forward to that next one. So thank you very much.
Says that science is adventure with a purpose. And I think John shared with us this evening both the adventure and the purpose. A remarkable, remarkable time. John has agreed to answer some questions. There are microphones up at the top here so that everyone can hear the question. Can people please come up to the microphone?
Hubble, we didn't know about any planets outside of our own solar system. while Hubble was operating, we observed Pluto, Charon, and two more moons of Pluto, and we demoted Pluto out of planet status. But in the meantime, we discovered over 350 planets outside of our own solar system, and this Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph actually has done an amazing feat of observing one of these planets as it goes in front and behind its parent star. And so a little bit of the light is blocked out when it's in front and goes back when it's behind. And Hubble has been able to observe, as a result, the atmosphere of the planet around a nearby star. So we've actually been able, from Earth, to look at the atmosphere of a planet around a nearby star. By restoring this instrument, we're going to be able to increase the number of planets that we can do that. Now, on that planet, it was a big Jupiter-like planet. We saw sodium and maybe, and normal things that we expect to see. Maybe a little methane, which these gas giants are full of methane. But imagine when we find an Earth-like planet around a nearby star and do the same trick. And if we were to see, nitrogen and carbon dioxide and oxygen, if we were to see non-equilibrium, a lot of oxygen, we could infer that there's some process going on like life. Now, we couldn't guarantee it. But what if we saw fluorocarbons and other pollutants in the atmosphere? Then we could, seriously, we could confirm that there's life on the planet, and we could rule out intelligence.
John, just seeing you out there exposed in a medical space, I would be petrified of space junk. And the little bits of debris that just keep getting pulverized in this launch form. What are the statistics? Have there been any incidents with astronauts getting hit by space junk or by the space shuttle getting any serious damage from the space shuttle?
So we have a lot of experience with this on the space shuttle. We have experience with it on the Hubble Space Telescope. In fact, on one of the large dish antennas, there's a hole about an inch across with something zipping through and just pulverizing it. On the space station, we have International Space Station. It's been up since 19, parts of it have been up since 1998. We can see where it's been hit. We've actually put out experiments to evaluate this. The long-duration exposure facility was up for almost 10 years. And so we see that these things are hit constantly by little bits of space debris. It's actually a little bit surprising, given the number of spacewalks that we've done between Hubble and the International Space Station, that an astronaut hasn't gotten hit. But fortunately, we go out for 6, 7, 8 hours at a time, and the rest of the time we're taking it inside. Almost every shuttle flight, when we get the space shuttle back, and the teams go around and inspect it, we find something that's been hit. Very often we have to change a window because it's been hit. And we don't have that little super glue suction cup thing yet. I'm from Texas. People get dings on their windshields all the time. They're in distress. So that it is a problem. We've just been lucky.
Yeah, and I just had one question. What was the alarms? I think you said there were two alarms. One
on the computer and the slideshow. Yeah, the first alarm, thank you, Greg. The first alarm was actually a flight control channel. We had an electrical short. And when the main engine started, it shook some little piece of metal that caused a short in an electronics box that controls the flight controls. Actually a pretty serious problem. Fortunately, the designers put four of those systems in parallel, so all we did was ignore one channel. And I guess they felt like they were kind of flaky when they built the shuttle, so they decided we needed four. And actually, it's because it's such a critical system. It has four, and a computer votes on the best of three. So that wasn't a big problem. We weren't sure whether it was a false fail or an actual short, or later it was a short. But if it had happened even a few seconds earlier, the main engines were to shut down, and we'd probably just be launching now, by now, the time it would take to reschedule the mission. So it was good that it happened just late enough that we still launched, and not so serious that we had the redundancy. The second alarm was actually a little bit worse. It was a liquid hydrogen level sensor, a pressure sensor, that indicated actually that one of the engines was failing. And it happened early enough in launch that had it been a real failure, they would have had us do a maneuver called return to the launch site abort, which means we'd get rid of those solid rocket motors, and we'd turn around, fly into our rocket plume, and try and get back to Florida before dumping the tank and landing. It's a theoretical procedure, and the community split it up. fail not by just disappearing, you know, like your, maybe your gas gauge. If you're driving along and you have 3/4 of a tank, all of a sudden it goes to zero, you can pretty much figure that the gauge has failed or the sensor has failed. If you're 3/4 and suddenly goes to full, you can figure it's failed. And if you were watching carefully and it weren't to move at all, you figure it's failed. But if you saw it slowly going down and shaking, you know, as it goes down, you might think, I have a leak in my gas tank. Well, this particular gauge failed by slowly, you know, shaking and going down, which is exactly the signature of an engine failing. And when they said no action, we were thinking, well, either it's a bad sensor, or they're saying there's really nothing we can do about it. And as soon as the engine does fail, we'll declare this return to launch site abort. We won't get to Hubble. This was a tough time to get to Hubble because from 2004 to 2006, there was no Hubble mission. It had been canceled. I know Professor Mike Turner in the audience experienced some of that while he was at the National Science Foundation. I happened to be at NASA headquarters at the time. And I think everybody was stunned. It really is that the community, the scientific community, and the public and Congress rallied. That Mike Griffin, the next administrator, was able to put it back on the manifest. And I thought after all that happened, I would have made it. Fortunately, it was a bad thing.
Good evening, John. You talked about the color filters that were placed in front of the Hubble actual camera and how the different color pictures were taken and then combined at the end. As a layman who never went beyond Astronomy 101, I could have wondered, what do those galaxies actually look like if we could see them with naked human eye?
That's a great question. Some of them look like what the pictures look like. If they pick, you know, red, green, and blue filter tech, does anybody have a digital camera in their hand?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's one right there. That camera actually has a similar CCD, chargeable device, image detector to Hubble. And but the manufacturers have put tiny little red, green, and blue filters around each pixel. And so there's actually 3 pixels for each. You know, when you say I have a 12 megapixel camera or a 10 megapixel camera, you actually have 3 little colors for each of those pixels. And so they put those filters permanently on the camera. On Hubble, we get to pick those filters one at a time. And so if you pick a red, green, and blue filter for a Hubble image and mix them in the right ratio, you could see the galaxy as if we could see it, except that the human eye, the Hubble is about 10 orders of magnitude more sensitive than the human eye. So it's very faint. But if you have really sensitive eyeballs, you're seen in those colors. Some things, though, are very different. We'll mix infrared color and ultraviolet color that we don't see at all. And we do that because that brings out the science in particular that we're looking for.
Excuse me. Up until a couple months ago, I used to live in Florida, and I've seen all 5 of your shuttle launches from the Kennedy Space Center. I'd like to ask a question. Is you've been on the shuttle a number of times. How would you feel about the shuttle program ending?
It's a great question. We've flown the shuttle since 1981. We've lost 2 orbiters. The space shuttle system, the space transportation system, is really the most phenomenal assemblage of equipment we've ever put together for space travel, or almost any. It is one of the most complex machines ever built. Miles of wiring on a piece of it at the work rate. And that complexity has allowed us to do some amazing things, like the servicing the Hubble. The Hubble Space Telescope project is really the best marriage of the human spaceflight program and the robotic science program. And then on each of our visits, servicing visits, we've been able to reinvent the telescope. First time to repair its optics, bring new instruments, and on subsequent trips, really renew the telescope. So we have not had one Hubble Space Telescope in essence. We actually have 3 or 4 space telescopes enabled by the robotic capability, the big payload bay, the people who go out in spacesuits and repair. On the other hand, it is an aging system, and I think it's quite wise that we complete the assembly of the International Space Station and repair the shuttle before we lose another one. It's very hard, very expensive to maintain the level of safety that we've been able to maintain, even then we've lost 2 crews. So what we're looking at in the next generation of rocket is to build things that have also great capability, slightly different focus, but
much, much safer. We're shooting for basically 10 times safer.
I've heard that you're related to Max Adler that started the Adler Planetarium. Is this correct?
Actually, I don't think that's correct. My grandfather was the architect of the Adler Planetarium, and so he and Max Adler, Max Adler, of course, built the Adler Planetarium, and after a trip to the Zeiss factory in 1929, on a steamship on the way back, my grandfather sketched out the design and approved it, and off they went.
Okay.
First planetarium in the Western Hemisphere.
The big question is, the Apollo astronauts saw flashes inside their capsules. Of course, there wasn't any shielding, and the flashes, they said, were the particles from the solar wind. As you were in space, did you see these things, and were you protected from them, and how did that affect your body?
I was going to say, yep, they were crazy. but in fact, I have seen those flashes. All astronauts have the capability to see those. Typically, though, it takes about 30 minutes for your eyes to darken out in the dark room. Same thing is true in space. Once, if you go to sleep at night and wear eye shades and earplugs, as most astronauts do, just because of 16 sunrises and sunsets a day, you can see a lot of that. Other people make strange noises. People snore in space, people are warmer than and so earplugs. But once your eyes are dark adapted, you get start seeing the cosmic rays. And these are not just, these are mostly solar cosmic rays, they're protons moving at very, very high speeds, some of the most close to the speed of light. And galactic cosmic rays. And our eyes are little cosmic ray detectors, so they can be seen. There's really not anything that you can do to shield against these within reason. In fact, if you were to do something like lighting inside of the space shuttle with lead, it would make it worse. So, because the protons would hit the lead and spallate, sort of explode, create more cosmic rays. So it's actually one of the neat things having gone to the University of Chicago, got my PhD in cosmic ray physics to see this and experience it firsthand. I was trying to classify singly charged particles and heavier nuclei, which ones are scintillation and which ones are turning off light by their color, things like that.
John, on this mission, were you able to take a little time to look at the beauty of the Earth or the Milky Way at night? And do you hope to go up to space again to enjoy those views?
I'll answer the second one first. The question was, would I like to go to space again? I would love to go to space again. I think my chances are vanishingly small, just because of the number of astronauts, and that we are moving to only some flights to the International Space Station. The next vehicle really probably won't come online in 2017. And with 5 space flights, I'm way at the end of the line. And on this mission, because we have 2 weather wave off days, actually have time to do a star party for the crew and point things out. Took some star pictures, set up a camera, long exposures, 20 seconds, 30 seconds. That's a thunder
now. Hi, I have 2 questions. How far back in space and time can I see? And the second question is, do you think amino acids came from comets or meteorites?
So, great question. Recent observations with Hubble have seen, and for those folks that mean something, have seen probably redshift 9 galaxies, certainly 8.8 or so, which means we're looking back, so the universe is about 13.7 billion years old, that's pretty firm, and we're looking back to around 12.8 billion years. So we're seeing the first galaxies that formed. They tend to be funny looking. They tend to be mostly hydrogen. They haven't built up these heavy metals that allow us to exist yet. And Hubble's now with this new camera peering back. So when we first put Hubble up, we got the Hubble Deep Field. This was a region in the Northern Hemisphere that we looked at. Bob Williams, then director of the Space Telescope Science Institute, knew was not a very heavily populated region. There was stuff there, but it wasn't a lot. So we spent 11 days to look at that field, and there were thousands of galaxies that came out. How many people have seen that Hubble Deep Field picture? Wonderful picture. Then when we put the advanced camera for surveys in, we did something called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. Again, we looked for days on end in one region. We saw
tens of thousands of these galaxies, and much closer to the first galaxies that formed in the universe. Now with this new Wide Field Camera 3, what took 11 days to do with Hubble, which is precious time, we did in 10 hours. We did the deep field in 10 hours. And now we've continued to add on to that and discovered these very early galaxies. We're going to do that in what's called super duper ultra deep field. But that's part of the program that's ongoing. And so we think we'll be able to see back to about the first 700 million years of the first galaxies were formed. The next telescope, the James Webb Space Telescope, will launch in 2014, which is an infrared telescope much better suited for studying that very early universe and actually even further back, maybe even the time the first stars were had cleared out enough stuff that you can see them from here. I think it's just amazing that here we are, 2009, we have telescopes orbiting the Earth that can look back and essentially unravel the history of the universe. Pretty phenomenal. The second question was about amino acids, and I think it's pretty clear that wherever we look in the galaxy around us, we see organic molecules in these clouds. And meteorites are filled with organic molecules, comets. It seems ubiquitous that there is organic material out there. So it's very likely that in that early phase of the solar system, a lot of stuff is drinking down on the surface of the Earth. Now, there's some peculiarities having to do with the polarity of molecules that we're made of. It could be a light processor, because in space they tend to be all polarized equally, left and right handed. But it's very likely that a lot of early life components came from space, because chemistry in space is going on the same way it does in the laboratory. We see all those organic molecules and amino acids. And we've seen at least one amino acid that we're made of. So we really are made out of star stuff.
Good evening. First of all, how honored and privileged we've all been to have you here tonight. To your knowledge, do we have anything in space which is in a geocentric orbit which can stop, change direction three times, shoot off in the opposite direction out of sight in the space of 2 seconds, and not be seen? And the reason that I ask you is because while I was in Napier, New Zealand on New Year's Eve 2006, New Year's Eve waiting for fireworks to go off, I noticed what I thought was a satellite, pointed it out to my wife and a gentleman standing behind me. And while we were all looking at it, it stopped, changed direction, zigzagged three times, went off in an opposite direction, not to be seen. And I turned around and said, please tell me that you all saw what I saw.
Actually, every time the space shuttle launches, I can tell you about my experience, we carry enormous amounts of ice up with us. And that ice hangs around the orbiter and slowly spreads out for days on end. And it's just incredible to see, you know, something that you don't know how big it is, you can't tell how far away it is. And these things do, you know, as they're sublimating, they're electrically floating jets and things, and they're rotating. And since you can't tell how far away they are or how big they are, and your brain tries to figure that out from some cues, and you're in orbit, there are no cues. So your brain can just invent stuff. So we see UFOs all the time. We see weird behavior of things that once you get out the really long lens of the binoculars, so far it's universally turned out to be ice on the orbit. And so we see a lot of weird things. We also see other spacecraft while we're in orbit. Rare, but if we're going into a night phase, we can still be in daytime but looking across the terminator so that Earth is black underneath. But a satellite with high altitude will still be in the sun. So we'll get to see that. It's also all sorts of interesting other spacecraft. But I've never seen anything quite the way you've described it. On the other hand, I find it hard to believe that a spacecraft would travel across the galaxy, taking, you know, for us what would be many, many lifetimes, arrive on planet Earth, land in a New Zealand farmer's field, pick up a cow and a farmer, dissect them, put them back, and then leave, and not come to the artists from Chicago.
I was watching the last mission, the first space.
Plan A was to take the wrench and release the bolt. Now, there's a wrench, and then there's something called a torque wrench, and that was to prevent us from breaking the bolt. And so the bolt was theoretically installed at 38 foot-pounds of torque. We had a torque wrench, so that's what you would set and tighten it. That was in 1993, and that was the setting they used. When that didn't work, I immediately went down and got another torque motor, which was set at 45, just another device, because plan B was, okay, we'll try it at a higher torque, but the limiting torque at 45 is below the failure torque of the bolt. So that was plan B. Plan C was to take the torque motors out entirely and try and turn it with the knowledge that if you exceeded the torque of about 58 foot-pounds, the shaft of the bolt would actually shear, which would leave the old instrument installed, but safe. Because the worst case would be to shear the threads, but the instrument would come out, but you can't put a new one in. Then you'd lose all of them. So the designers were pretty clever. They designed the shaft to shear at a lower torque that would protect the telescope. So that we actually got to plan C before we were successful. Now the interesting thing is, you know, Drew in that video says, you know, turn. There's two reasons it can turn. Either it came loose, or he broke it. And so I sort of waited. I said, yes, it did turn. But I waited until he turned a little more, and I saw the instrument start to come out before I actually relaxed a little bit. But again, it was like the alarms on launch. I couldn't believe that we'd come this far in the very first task. Now we've been working at this pursuit with her family. So thanks.
Welcome back to Earth.
Thank you.
Peeking out the window when you're in space, looking at Earth, and you see all those shining lights from Earth, can you speak a little bit about the lights that you see at night from the big cities? And then zooming in on that city called DC, can you tell us a little bit about what it was like being a guest at the first star party at the White House?
Actually, I'll extrapolate a little bit on that. Looking at planet Earth, we hear stories about the Apollo astronauts in particular, actually Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo, about how beautiful the blue Earth is, and that from space you can't see borders, people born to live together. But I have no idea where they got those stories, because in 15 years of flying in space, on my first mission in 1995, you see plenty of borders. In South Korea, you see thousands of megawatts of light being radiated into space from all the industry and the cities. And then you see a super bright line in that division between North and South Korea. And in North Korea, you see one light bulb. All over Asia at night, you see lots of city lights and fires. That's rainforest to be clear cut. Over Brazil and Central America at night, fires everywhere. So they're cutting forests. Farms around the world. Farmers would rather burn fields than cut them and till them under. It's just easier. And so you also see during the day side smoke trails that come from continents across oceans. If you look at Israel, for instance, in the Middle East, you see a nice green country surrounded by desert as they manage their war differently. Out in the middle of the desert, you see these in Egypt, there's a center point irrigation all over it, so they're draining an aquifer that will last maybe 80, 100 years, at which point they'll be dry. And millions of people they've relocated to the desert, well, a huge drought, which is the subject of the next in this series, water and oil. So I encourage you to come and hear that. The striking thing is that everywhere I've seen on planet Earth, virtually everywhere I've seen, you can see the imprint of humans. How they change the environment. And that's not an understatement, it's just an observation. Zooming into DC, actually, when you fly over DC, they picked a different kind of lamp for their street lamps than Maryland and Virginia surrounding them. And so you actually see a little square box as the light changes. Actually, being in the middle of those lights 3 weeks ago, I think it was, for the first star party in the White House lawn, it was really thrilling. We had 20 telescopes, we had about 150 kids from Maryland and Virginia. And in the district, really, really great kids, very interested in science. I had one of my EVA gloves, and the spark on the kids' eye when they found the EVA glove was wonderful for me. I could see them president did do some observing, and we had a little inflatable dome that he went in and got a little star talk. He came around and touched the moon rock and a Mars meteorite that we had, and a bunch of other stuff. Said some really wonderful things about education, which is science and technology education. One other soapbox, all I'll say is we are now educating the first generation of young people who will be less well educated than we were. And we have to change that. That's without question. That should be one of our highest priorities, and the president talked about that. So I think that was just a wonderful event. Thank you for asking.
Let me say again what a privilege it is for the Department of Astronomy and Astrophysics to partner with C2ST and with the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. I think it has been a magic evening. And what a great privilege it is to have John Grunsfeld come home and share his adventures with us. Let's thank John.